In this video, we're developing a formula for the magnetic field generated by a moving point charge, and then we're going to work an example where we look at the magnetic force between two moving charges. And I have to start with an apology on this one. The formula I'm about to construct is actually not exactly right, but this is the standard introduction given in second semester engineers physics, and the point is that it allows us to motivate the Biot-Savart law for computing the magnetic field due to a steady current. So the formula we're going to develop actually is valid in the low velocity limit, meaning as long as the speed is much less than the speed of light. But the proper proof of the formula is well beyond the scope of a lower division course. So with that disclaimer, we have a diagram of a charge Q moving with a velocity V, and we've chosen an observation point at some arbitrary location. Our standard approach to setting up the diagram is that we'll use a position vector to point from the source charge to the observation point, and we call that r, and we see that r makes an angle of theta with the velocity axis. Now, the magnetic field due to this moving charge is really strange. It loops around the direction of motion according to a right-hand rule. So if you put the thumb of your right hand in the direction of motion, your fingers are going to curl in the direction that the magnetic field loops around. And the way I've shown it here, I'm also trying to communicate that the strength of the magnetic field also depends on direction. Perpendicular to the direction of velocity, we get a maximum strength to the magnetic field, and along the velocity axis, we actually see zero magnetic field. And we'll get back to the particulars of that directional dependence in just a minute. So the point for now is that the magnetic field at our observation point points out of the page. So now we can start to construct our formula for a magnetic field through some relatively simple proportionalities. First, the magnetic field magnitude is going to be proportional to the size of the charge. And that makes a lot of sense. If we double the charge, it should double the magnetic field strength. Second, the magnetic field magnitude should be proportional to the speed. So if our charge moves twice as fast, we get twice the magnetic field strength. Next, we need to take care of that weird directionality thing. B is zero on the velocity axis and maximum at 90 degrees to the velocity axis. And this is actually because B is proportional to the sine of theta. Now we can combine rules 2 and 3 in a way that formally takes care of the direction and velocity dependence of B. And we do that by using a cross product. So what we're going to do is we define r hat as a unit vector, in other words, a vector of length 1, pointing in the direction of r, and then we're going to cross v into r hat. So the cross product gives the product of the magnitudes of the two vectors that we're dealing with times the sine of the angle between them. And because the magnitude of a unit vector is 1, that's going to give us a magnitude of v sine theta, taking care of two of our proportionalities in one step. But there's a bonus here. When we cross these vectors, we sweep the fingers of the right hand from v to r hat, and our thumb points in the direction of the cross product. Well, that's outward, which is the direction of the magnetic field. So we're taking care of two proportionalities and the direction of b in a single cross product. Finally, our magnetic field should drop off with distance, and it turns out to be a 1 over r squared law, just like electric fields and just like gravitational fields. Now we can wrap all these proportionalities into a single statement for the magnetic field generated by a point charge, again, keeping in mind that there's a way deeper story going on here, and this is just a low velocity limit of the correct answer. So there it is, the field generated by a moving point charge with the caveat that it's actually an approximation. So we write it as B is equal to mu naught over 4 pi times Q times the cross product of V crossed into R hat divided by R squared, the length of R squared. So what about that constant of proportionality? We're meeting a new constant of nature here, and this is called the permeability of free space mu naught. And mu naught turns out to be 4 pi times 10 to the negative 7 Tesla meters per amp. Note that even this constant comes with a caveat, because it was slightly adjusted in 2019 when the elementary charge E was fixed to 9 decimal places in the SI system of units. But most introductory textbooks are still going to use the 4 pi. So now that we have our general formula for the field generated by a moving charge, we can work a simple example. So our example is purely symbolic this time. And in our example, we're given two positive charges, each with a magnitude of q, and they're both moving with the same speed of v but in opposite directions, and we're asked to compute the magnetic force on the upper charge at the point of closest approach, in other words, the situation that's shown in the diagram, and we're told the charges are separated by a distance of little r. So the first thing we want to do in these problems is to get everything into the diagram like it was in the derivation of our formula. So we want the magnetic force on the upper charge, which means we need to compute the magnetic field there due to the lower charge, and then we're going to use the Lorentz force law to get the force. So with the bottom charge being our source charge and the top charge being our observation point, I draw the position vector from the source to the observation point. That's this vertical vector now that I call r with a vector over it, and that has a magnitude of little r. Now the angle between the velocity vector and our position vector is 90 degrees this time, and we can draw a unit vector in the direction of the position vector. That's r hat. It has a length of 1 and points straight up in this case. And when we perform the cross product of v crossed into r hat, we're sweeping the fingers of our right hand from the direction of v to the direction of r hat, which puts our thumb pointing out of the page. That's going to be the direction of the magnetic field detected at that upper charge. So we use a circle with a dot inside to indicate that that field is pointing out of the page. So with all that labeling done, we're ready to go ahead and write down the formula for the magnetic field generated by that lower charge. All right, so we have that the magnetic field vector is given by mu naught over 4 pi times q times the cross product of v crossed into r hat, all divided by r squared. And we know the direction of B is going to be outward because we already looked at the geometry of the cross product here. So we're going to just talk about a magnitude of B. That's just a B without a vector over the top. And so what I need in my numerator here is the magnitude of the cross product. Now remember, that's the product of the two vector magnitudes that are involved in the cross product. The first one is V and the second one is 1. By design, R hat has a length of 1. And then you have to multiply by the sine of the angle between them. Well, in this case, that angle is 90 degrees, and the sine of 90 degrees is 1. So we quickly arrive at an expression for our magnetic field magnitude at the location of the upper charge. So that's going to be a mu naught q times v over 4 pi r squared. Next, we need to figure out the force on this upper positive charge due to the presence of that magnetic field. So for this, we're using the Lorentz force law. And again, this involves a cross product. So we have that the vector force on this upper charge is given by q times the vector v crossed into b. So this time, if we take the fingers of our right hand and point them to the left in the direction of v, we can sweep out to the direction of b through an angle of 90 degrees again, and our thumb points straight up. So it turns out our magnetic force is going to be straight up. In other words, these two charges must be repelling each other due to their magnetic interaction. So to get the magnitude of this force, I have q times the magnitude of the cross product again, which is the magnitude of the two participant vectors. That's v times b times the sine of the angle between them. This time v is in the plane of the page and b points straight out of the page, making them at right angles again, and the sine of 90 degrees is 1. So all we have to do is take our magnetic field magnitude, which we got in the previous step, and multiply it by an additional factor of q and an additional factor of v. So as it turns out, my magnetic force is going to be mu naught q squared v squared divided by 4 pi r squared, and that's the end of our example. In the next video, we're going to use this formula for the magnetic field generated by a point charge to derive the Biot-Savart law. And that's a formula that tells us how to compute the magnetic field due to a steady current in a wire with any arbitrary shape. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left when it's done, and I'll see you there.